Hey, I'm Melkey, and I'm a senior software engineer at Twitch, and I'm also a content creator. I created this course for individuals who are interested in learning Go, regardless of where they are in their career. In this course, we develop our own HTTP server. We connect via a database layer to our database. We have our own API handlers to accept incoming requests from our clients. We have our own tests, and we build a real-world project structure. Take what you learned from this course and build some amazing Go projects. Who does this course benefit the most? I think that's probably an important question to ask. And it's really simple, kind of going back to the objective function of this course. And it's anyone who's interested in learning the Go programming language. And again, that's kind of it. I can move on to the next slide, but I'm not going to. It's a very simple kind of mission statement, if you think about it, because it covers a lot of ground, right? If you're someone who's like a junior engineer, right? Let's say you're very green, like out of school, or you're just learning it, and you maybe tinker around with JavaScript or TypeScript or Python, one of those first languages that introduces people to programming. I think Go is a great first language to learn. I truly think when we think about first programming languages, Python, JavaScript are 1-2. I don't see any reason why Go is not in that conversation. I actually would make the argument that Go is probably better than the other two, because if you want to make a solid career as an engineer, as a programmer, as a developer, Go will expose more elements of computer science than JavaScript and Python, right? There's just more, you know, intricacies about Go. I'm not saying it's like the lowest level implementation, because when you go lower, the barrier to entry for a new person is kind of tougher, right? You're not going to really recommend someone brand new something like C, right, or Rust, or maybe you would, but I think a lot of the time if you do that, there's a chance some people may get discouraged, right, because programming's hard, especially if you're new. Like, I don't know if you remember the first time you wrote code, you're probably like, oh, I don't get how this works. And so I think Go is just, it's a very subtle way to get introduced to programming, and it introduces quote unquote advanced intermediate topics that Python and JavaScript kind of abstract. But it's also good for people with experience. So let's say you're a mid-level engineer and you've been, you know, mastering your tools, which could be web dev or could be something else, but you want to make a transition, right? You want to go from front end to back end. Something piques your interest. Go, again, is a great language to seek out in that endeavor, because I think other languages may have different criteria for use cases, right? Maybe have different boilerplates attached to them, which makes everything kind of overwhelming. I think if you're first kind of interested in backend languages and you need to see if it's truly something for you, I think Go is a great language that does that. And then even for seniors, even if you're a senior engineer and you've been mastering Go for a long time, I do hope there's going to be things in this course that either remind you about certain topics of Go that maybe you've forgotten, or maybe introduce something new that you didn't even think of implementing in your own project. So I truly hope this covers a wide array of people who want to learn Go, who are going out of their way to learn Go, or maybe have heard of it, have this kind of itch, and then hopefully this course scratches that itch. So the first method of declaring a variable is using the keyword var, the name of the variable, and then the type of the variable. All right, so it's gonna be a string, and we can say this is gonna be Melkey. Okay? The compiler is once again yelling at us because we have an unused variable. So if you have any unused variables in your code, you will not be able to compile. You won't be able to run your project. So again, unused imports, unused variables, we don't like that in Go. To print this, instead of using print line, which is the first print statement I used when we started this, I'm gonna use something called printf. And printf formats according to a format specifier and writes to standard output, okay? Now, what that means is it's gonna first take what we want, so the template string here, I'm gonna say, this is my name, and then the formatter, right? So different data types have different formatters. A string is modulo s. I might say percent sign s or modulo. I am referring to this symbol right here. Key distinction between printf and printline: print line gives you a free line. Printf does not. So you have to specify the line break with forward slash n, like so. Okay, and then with printf, the arguments are going to come into the order they appear in the template string from left to right. So here we have one, it's going to be a string, and pass in our name like so. We can save this, and we can just quickly run main.go, and we should see this is my name, Melkey. All right, so that's one method of declaring a variable. Another is type inferencing. So the compiler can actually inference a type for us. The way you can do this, let's say we have an age. Let's say the age is 27. You can see here, it looks vastly different than the var name, but this is still a variable that now the compiler is inferring the type for us. It's going to infer that 27 is of type int, okay? So we can do the exact same thing, format printf. Okay, we can say this is my age, and then the format specifier for an int is modulo d. Again, do not forget the break line, and we can put age. Okay, now if we save this, you can see this is my name Melkey and this is my age. So Go has the ability to infer, and we can do the same thing with name as well. We can just do name with the shorthand operator. Okay, I think this is called like the walrus operator in Python. To declare something and have Go infer the type for us. Okay, another method is to declare but reassign later. So we can do var, keyword, the name, city, and then the type, string. And we can just leave it like this. This is fine. So different than the first variation, we didn't explicitly set what city is because the compiler is only yelling at us, hey, it's declared and not used. What's going on? So we could do something like this, and then we can say city equals to Seattle. All right, and again, we can do the exact same thing, format.printf, we can say this is my city, okay, format with the module operator and say city like so. And we can now see we have Melkey, age, CL. We have a few of these structs now. We have person, contact, employee. We're gonna kind of shift our focus on the person struct because something I wanted to address is this topic of passing values by reference or copies of each other, right? So let's say we have this function called func modify person name, okay? And let's say this function is going to accept a person type. So again, we can just do person and actually type in our person type here. Because now person, if we look at a definition, it's a type, it's our struct. It's fully something that we can use and define, right? This function's not going to return anything because we're gonna try and modify a value. So here, what I'm going to write, let me just make some more room here. Let's do format print line name before, and we can access the property of our struct. We can do person.name like so. All right, here I'm gonna do modify person name. I'm gonna pass my person that we declared. And over here, what I'm going to do is person.name. We'll set this to Melkey. All right, and we can put format.println inside scope, new name. We can put person.name just to demonstrate that we did in fact modify something in our code here. And then above, after we call the function in our parent function, the main function, we can say name after. Okay, so if I run this, you can see name before is John. Inside scope, new name is Melkey, name after is John. Okay, because what's happening here is the person that we've passed in our modify person name function is a copy of the actual person that we declared all the way up here. Okay, so when we change the property name of the copied person, this only exists in the scope of our function. Once the function is executed, this variable, this person copy is deleted, it is no longer there, and that memory is then reallocated or it's freed up. If you want to pass a value by reference, right? So if you actually want to call the address and modify the address of a variable, what we can do is change the type of modify person name to accept a pointer to person. This is the syntax for pointers. It is this asterisk here. And this basically says this function accepts person, but the type is a pointer to person, okay? And then we can see here, we cannot use variable of type person as pointer person because we need to pass in the address of our person variable. And to do this, we can use the ampersand symbol, if I'm not mistaken. And this directly is the address of our person. Okay, so now because person here is a pointer to this person variable that we've created, once we modify person.name, we can simply go back, right? If I save this now, run this, now the value persists because we are no longer creating a copy of person that lives within the scope of the function. We did the database layer, we did the API layer, we just have to do one last layer, which is the easiest, and that's routing it across our application, which we know how to do. We first should start in the app.go, like so. And now, since we've introduced a new store, we can go all the way up here. Okay, let's first create the new user handler, api.userHandler, like so. And then right here, we can do user store, store.new, Postgres user store, pass pgdb, and in here, user handler, api.new user handler, we'll pass in the user store and the logger, like so. And then underneath user handler, we'll pass in the user handler. Last thing we gotta do is go into our routes and let's do r.post. This is gonna be /users. And here app.user handler handle you register user. All right. So now we have fully connected everything. Again, we did this one much faster, but we've connected our user database to our user API across our app through our routes. Only thing left is to test it. So we have this handle register user, go to your running Go server. You can nuke that, run go, run main.go. See if you have any obvious errors. I do not, that's good. Make sure your Docker is still running. Okay. Check, select all. Oh. Okay, if you have that issue, so you can just, I'm just double checking that it's to confirm I don't have any users in my database. Select all from users. PSQL shows me it is empty. And if I just go back to the post_notes.txt, if I go down to section 3.1 right here, I've provided an example payload request for you to copy and paste into your terminal or into your URL application or API application. So paste this, you can see here it's curl-x post, which is the method, localhost 8080 users, the application type, and then the payload, which includes a username, email, password, and bio. So if I click enter, you can now see we've gotten a response. User ID 1, username, email, bio, created at and updated at. And now if I go to PSQL and run the exact same command to check if we have a user, you now should see we do in fact have our username John Doe with all of their credentials. And you can notice the password is in fact hashed.